His book, number 704, for the, I'm sorry, for the beauty of the earth, number 704.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts, in my words, in what I have done, in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly
Oremus. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. God did not make death, nor does he rejoice in the destruction of the living. For he fashioned all things that they might have being, and the creatures of the world are wholesome, and there is not a destructive drug among them, nor any domain of the netherworld on earth, for justice is undying. For God formed man to be imperishable. The image of his own nature he made him. But by the envy of the devil, death entered the world, and they who belong to his company experience it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's second reading is taken from St. Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, as you excel in every respect, in faith, discourse, knowledge, all earnestness, and in the love we have for you, may you excel in this gracious act also. For you know the gracious act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, for your sake he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. Not that others should have relief while you are burdened, but that as a matter of equality, your abundance at the present time should supply their needs, so that their abundance may also supply your needs, that there may be equality. As it is written, whoever had much did not have more, and whoever had little did not have less. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a large crowd gathered around him, and he stayed close to the sea. One of the synagogue officials named Jairus came forward. Seeing him, he fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with him, saying, "My daughter is at the point of death. Please come lay your hands on her, and she may get well and live." He went off with them. And a large crowd followed him and pressed upon him. There was a woman afflicted with hemorrhages for 12 years. She had suffered greatly at the hands of many doctors and had spent all that she had. Yet she was not helped, but only grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. She said, "If I but touch his clothes, I shall be cured." Immediately her flow of blood dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of her afflictions. Jesus, aware at once that power had gone out from him, turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who has touched my clothes?" But his disciples said to Jesus, "You see how the crowd is pressing upon you, and yet you ask, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. The woman, realizing what had happened to her, approached in fear and trembling. She fell down before Jesus and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has saved you. Go in peace and be cured of your affliction. While he was still speaking, people from the synagogue official's house arrived and said, Your daughter has died. Why trouble the teacher any longer? Disregarding the message that was reported, Jesus said to the synagogue officials, Do not be afraid. Have faith. He did not allow anyone to accompany him inside except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they arrived at the house of the synagogue official, he caught sight of a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. So he went in and said to them, Why this commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but asleep. And they ridiculed him. Then he put them out. He took along the child's father and mother and those who were with him and entered the room where the child was. He took the child by the hand and said to her, Talitha kum, which means, Little girl, I say to you, arise. The girl, a child of 12, arose immediately and walked around. At that, they were utterly astounded. He gave strict orders that no one should know this and said that she should be given something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good morning. This morning we hear in the Book of Wisdom that it is not God who brings about or creates death, but rather that death comes because of the envy of the devil. What does this mean, that death comes about by the envy of our enemy? Well, God is life straight through. It is his very essence. This is why Jesus says, I come that you might have life and have it to the full, that you might have it more abundantly. In fact, he will enter into death, Jesus will, by his cross, precisely to put to death death, to conquer it once and for all, and to fill even our sufferings with newness of life, that death now will become a doorway to the eternal life, hopefully into the heavenly realm. The enemy does not like God. And so he wants to attack life itself. He attacks God and anything that bears his image, his imprint, or even has a part of participation in his essence, which we do. We are made in God's image and likeness, and we possess life and are even promised life eternal. And so the enemy is going to attack that. We see that, of course, with attacks against the most innocent in our world, those children who are in the womb, and as well upon those who are most vulnerable, the elderly, we see with euthanasia. But the attack that the enemy has is against life in general. As a result, then, when it comes to death, we often just simply like to avoid the conversation of it. We don't like to face it. In fact, we would rather just simply maybe blame God for death or just avoid it altogether. This is why sometimes we will see people when their loved one is taken from them in this life. Who does that person blame? They blame God. Why, God, did you take this person from me? Well, it is not God who has caused death. And likewise, again, we oftentimes avoid the conversation. And so we just live kind of in a culture that longs to live forever. And we see this by how much money is spent on healthcare. We would just like to live forever, not have to deal with the reality that our days here on earth are numbered. The Lord knows how many days we have on this life. We do not know how many we have. The saints in the church have often had a motto which helps them to keep perspective and to really grow in holiness, and that motto is memento mori. That is, remember death. Saint Francis of Assisi would call death sister death, knowing that death would draw an end to this earthly life, put an end to sin, and really again be the doorway into eternal life. And he saw it as a merciful blessing in the end. Some saints, like Saint Jerome and Saint Teresa of Avila, would actually have a human skull on their desk as they would write and as they would contemplate to remind them they don't have all the time in the world, that God gives us so many days to be used for his greater glory, to be used wisely and not frivolously. We should spend our time well. That being said, these words, memento mori, really kind of hit home for me the other evening when many of you might have been watching the presidential debate. I was listening to it on the radio as I drove home from offering Mass up in St. Charles. And so I listened to the presidential debate, and for many of you, you saw two gentlemen in the twilight of their years. I could hear their voices. That's what I was focusing in on. And it reminded me that even though I'm 43, there's going to come a day where I might be like that. Or I might not be. I have no idea. Today could be my last day on earth. We never know, right? So I presumed that someday I might be in my 80s. But us Gerbers, we kind of like to check out early. Thank you, Chicago. Good night, you know, sort of thing. You know, we just, for some reason, our heart gives in right around 60s or 70s. So I never know. And it made me think, as the two men on the stage were talking, and as all the commentators then started talking about their old age and how one might have looked like more like death than the other and so forth, that it made me wonder, what am I spending my life on? Now, of course, the presidential election is very important, of course. But in the end, what are we really spending our lives on? And what will I be focused on in my last hours, my last days? For me, I hope that if the Lord should grant me a fullness of years and I should be in my 80s, the one thing that I will not be thinking about is having a public argument about my golf handicap, which is one of the arguments that was had on Thursday night. It's frivolous. I hope that in my last hours and with my last breaths, I might be able to impart wisdom. Or maybe if there are some regrets that I've had in this life, that I might be able to recognize them and make a good confession. Or maybe even that I might be able to look back at life with a sense of gratitude, that knowing that without God I was able to do nothing, but with God he did so much through me, and I could maybe look back at his glory through my life, and that I didn't waste my life. I hope that the prayers I have offered to God, the intercession of Saint Joseph for a happy death, might come to pass. Saint Joseph is the patron of a happy death. He's known as that because he dies in the arms of Jesus and Mary. And that's where I want to be when I pass from this life. So memento mori, remember death. Some of the ancients would say carpe diem, seize the day, but that's not enough. Because it's not just simply enough to seize the day. We must remember that we're going to be judged for how we seize the day. That we're going to come face to face with the author of life who came to give us life to the full. And so it is fine to have chocolate cake and a glass of wine. It's great to enjoy fireworks and to celebrate the independence of our country, to praise God for these great gifts, as we should. But also remember that all this world comes to pass. And then the opening of the eternal life. now be judged on how I spent my days on this earth. Memento mori. When you pass from this life, will you have had an ability or will you have lacked a certain charity towards others? Will you have held on to resentment with those passing breaths that you have? What regrets will you have? Will you have died right with God, having made a good confession? Memento mori. With the hours that we have left, and we never know how many hours that we have, maybe this is the moment then that you can lavish mercy upon the person that you've been holding resentment towards. Even if they haven't asked for your forgiveness, you can give it anyway and be free. Or maybe we've been kind of miserly with our goods and with the things that God has given us. And maybe today's the day that we begin anew with generosity and a great trust in God's generosity towards us, that he will not be outdone in generosity, but will help us to give all the more. Maybe today's the day that we make a good confession. Maybe today's the day that we aren't frivolous with our life anymore. When I thought about the two men up on that political stage, and someday knowing that they will pass as you and I will pass, I wondered, who prays for them? And when they pass, who will pray for them? Then I made it personal. When I pass from this life, who will pray for me? Who will pray for you when you pass from this life? Maybe that's what can help spur us on then to pass on the faith with the hours and days that we have left. For that is the most noble of services that we can and deeds that we can do in this life is to pray to God and as well to pass on that faith. So maybe if you got wrapped up in the political dealings of this past Thursday, maybe we can spend our time now praying for those two men, praying for our country, and as well praying for ourselves. You can pray for yourself. There's nothing selfish in that. Saying, Lord, give me a happy death. Lord, help me make a good confession. And Lord, help me to pass on the faith that even people will pray for me when I pass from this life. God did not create death. It was from the envy of the enemy. But God entered into death and has now given it life. In the name of the Father and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We stand and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. With great confidence in our Heavenly Father, we bring to him now our petitions.
For Pope Francis, Archbishop Rozanski, and all clergy, that God will inspire and make fruitful their efforts in helping others to come to know Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For elected officials, that they may receive the graces needed to make the teachings of Christ the guiding principles for their decisions and actions, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and suffering, that Mary's example of faith and trust in God's holy will might give them hope and courage, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the faithful departed, that they may share in the gift and promise of eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our almighty and merciful Father, you who number our days aright, we beg you hear our prayers and bestow upon us your grace, that we may spend the life that you have given us wisely and to your greater glory, and that at the end of these days, we may be found worthy to enter the joys of your heavenly kingdom, where you live and reign forever and ever. Amen.
As our gifts are prepared, please join in singing number 525, Gift of Finest Wheat, number 525.
Thank you. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, grant, we pray, that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these sacred gifts. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death. And by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Mitchell, our Bishop, and all those who hold into the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, or they offer for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true, in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and counted among the flock of those you have chosen through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith.
Peace, bread, and drink this cup. We proclaim your death, O Lord. Until you come again.
Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them, as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing through Christ our Lord. Amen. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith, and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace through Christ our Lord. Amen. To us also, your servants, who, those sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, who beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Per ipsum et cum ipso et in ipsum, est tibi Deo Patri omnipotenti, in unitate Spiritus Sancti, omnis honor et gloria, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. O Father, I pray for them, that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me, says the Lord.
Our communion song is number 580. Lord, you have come. Number 580.
Let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord, we pray, so that bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Congratulations to Kay Beyer and Nora Helms, who were baptized last Sunday. Our recessional hymn is number 725, America the Beautiful, number 725.
May you all enjoy this wonderfully cooler weather this weekend, and may you all also have a very blessed July 4th. The Lord be with you. Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus. Amen.
The Mass has ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God. St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus, Immaculate Heart of Mary, Saint Joseph, and Saint Genevieve,